is Rebecca Lowell, and I'm with the Nebraska Veterans Memorial Foundation's Share Your Story project. I am here in Mount Horeb, Wisconsin, sharing my time with U.S. Army veteran Vernon Lowell, who has agreed to share his story for the Library of Congress Veterans History Project. Vern, let's begin with your full name and where you were born.
Vernon Howard Lowell. I was born in Wisconsin Rapids, Wisconsin, lived there for the first three quarters of my life.
Okay, did any of your brothers, sisters, parents, or anybody else serve in the military?
Yes, my brother Larry Lowell was in the Army before I was, and he was still in when I enlisted, and had stayed there for a full four-year term.
Okay. Where did you go to school when you graduated from high school? What happened after that?
When I graduated from high school, I went to University of Wisconsin in Madison, Wisconsin, and began my education.
What did you study?
I studied primarily basic stuff to begin with, and then after that, things related to government work.
Okay. Tell us about when you went into the military. Were you drafted or did you volunteer?
I knew that I was going to be drafted. I had received 3 years of deferments, and they decided that that was all they could afford to give me, and that they my mother got a call and that said they were going to be drafting me, and so I just decided to enlist.
Okay. What did you choose a particular branch for any reason? I mean, I knew you went in the Army. Did you choose the Army?
I went into the Army, but I didn't go in with any specific idea of what I would want to do, except that I wanted to be involved in government work.
Okay. And who did you leave behind?
I didn't leave anybody behind.
Were your parents both living when you went in?
Yes, my parents were both living. My brother was living. My sister was living.
And your sister was still in the home?
Right.
Right. Okay. So, tell me about your training. Where did you start and where did you end up?
I started in New Jersey at, we just said
Fort Dix.
Fort Dix. Fort Dix. And, you know, my first 12 weeks was primarily a basic introduction to being in the Army. And it was mostly some book work, some outdoor work, travel, a lot of heavy duty
infantry
training.
So you had your boot camp and your basic infantry course.
Right.
Fort Dix.
Right.
Okay. And then you went down to...
From there I went to OCS. I had signed up for OCS, was accepted, and went to Fort Benning, Georgia for the full term. And that was in, Fort Benning.
In Georgia.
Alabama.
Georgia.
Georgia.
Yeah. Okay. What was the best part of your training?
The best part? Well, it was learning about how the Army travels and works and gets a job in the Army, and that normally comes through the training they give you in OCS, in my case.
Did you have any additional specialized training, like what we would call the MOS training?
Yes, and I ended up going to a military intelligence school
I don't think you're supposed to tell us, but it's probably somewhere in like Virginia.
No, it wasn't Virginia, but it was, anyway, it was where the military intelligence school was at that point in time, and I had chosen that direction to go into the military intelligence unit. And I was there for 1 year, but more than a half a year or so.
You know, 8 or 9 months, yeah, something like that.
Several programs at that point.
What was the hardest part of military life for you to adapt to?
When I started, my previous work was mostly outdoor work and meeting with a lot of people. I worked late, long days and late, and so I was tired all the time. When I first got to basic training camp, I couldn't go to sleep at the time that they would put me to bed, and I didn't want to wake up when they woke me up, and that was the hardest part of it.
I think myself, having been in the Marine Corps, I remember those first, probably the first week, getting adapted,
right.
And then after that, you were like asleep the minute they turned the lights off and up,
right,
just before it came back on.
Eventually, you got to that point, yes.
Right, and so then you went over to Vietnam. Tell me, what part of Vietnam did you serve in?
I was in the second cabin, I was in the 11th Armored Cavalry Regiment. That's where I was assigned. And we were posted in Tukor. That's just short away from Saigon. So it was jungle. It was hot. We had two. It was hot and hot and dry, and or hot and
rainy.
wet. And that determined a lot of what we did and didn't do.
Were you in an actual combat role, a combat support role, or a combat service role?
Well, I started out not in a combat role at all. In my first month or so, my commander assigned me to the military way of what was happening, and so after about the first month of wandering around and trying to find something appropriate to do, I went out in the field to have a look out there. And one of my predecessors was about to leave the job of military intelligence for the 2nd Squadron of the 11th Armored Cavalry Regiment. I got appointed to that by the commander of that unit. And I spent the rest of my time doing that kind of work.
Okay. Did you form any special friendships or camaraderie while you were in the military?
Oh, sure. Lots. You had to have that, and that's about all you did have. And you tried to be as, quote, normal as you could be, which was very difficult. But my circumstances basically got me to, I was on duty 20 hours a day. I got 4 hours of sleep 7 days a week at night. And one of the other guys in the operations center would come in and wake me up at midnight, and I would be awakened from midnight till 4 o'clock in the morning, and then I was on duty until the next night.
Crazy. What did you do? You really didn't have a lot of free time then.
No.
How did you stay in touch with your family and friends?
Well, it was not like it is today. We tried a few things that didn't work very well. But, excuse me?
Show the card. You showed me this earlier, and I just thought it was just so special.
The one I sent her?
Yeah.
At Christmas?
Yeah.
Yeah, we tried to communicate as best we could. I can't.
That's okay.
Dig it out right now.
Okay.
But it took 10 days for me to send a CD, a card of what I had been doing for the week and how I was doing. And it would take 10 days for my wife to get it and to send back email, not email, back then it was just mail.
Letter.
Mail. And we kept up in that direction. I couldn't really talk with her about what I was doing and what it was like. So it was, you know, the discussions were fairly mundane between me and her. And she was able to tell me a lot more about what she was doing. Mm-hmm. Then I was able to tell her what I was doing.
And when did you get married?
We got married between the time I got my commission and the time that I went to Vietnam. And It was great when I finally got to come home.
Do you recall any particularly funny or encouraging events that happened while you were on active duty?
Well, not funny. We in 11th Armored Cav, 2nd Squadron, we operated out of areas where there were civilian people living there, but they were desperate for a lot of things. It was a difficult life for them, and we did a lot to provide them medical care and build schools for them and the kids and that sort of thing when we had some spare time to do it. But, you know, like I say, I was I was on duty every day.
Did you have any particular rituals or anything that you did for good luck or safety, or did you have a faith that sustained you?
I'm a Christian, and that did definitely make a difference. I came to be, I didn't come into the Army because I wanted to be a soldier as such. I came in because the government said they needed me. And as time went on, I found it to be less and less good, you know, in my mind. It was harder and harder to say everything was going fine, because that wasn't true. But at the same time, I felt that we were doing the best we could be doing for the circumstances. Okay. And I had a excellent, I learned a lot from a lot of people, all the way up to the general in charge of the Armored Cavalry Company.
And did you receive any special awards or recognition?
Yes, when I got home, I had 6 months left to serve. And this general is okay. The guy who awarded me.
Hold it open and there we go.
my bronze star.
Oh my goodness.
I mean, it was given to me overseas, but I didn't get it officially until I got home.
Wonderful. Thank you for sharing that. So then you had come home. Do you recall when your service ended?
Yeah, it ended in June of 19... must have been...
69?
69, something like that, yeah.
Where were you? Where were you stationed?
Well, I was in Washington at the time.
Okay.
And I came out through Washington. And the there's a military branch right outside of Washington, D.C., and that's where I actually came out. Don't remember the name we call that. It still exists.
It's a transition.
Yeah, sort of.
Okay. And then, did you return back home to Wisconsin?
Yes.
You did. And how was your service received? What did your family and friends and community think of your service?
Well, the interesting thing about it was, it wasn't like, that was a tough time in the U.S., because a lot of people didn't agree with the war. And I wasn't in that same situation. And I wasn't in the difficult situation that a lot of them were, because I had worked for long times, you know, civilian life, in addition to going to school. So I knew people, and I stopped immediately the day I arrived. Sylvia picked me up at the airport, and they brought me, we went downtown and on State Street. And
that's in Madison, right?
In Madison. And there was a difficult situation going on in town, and I was in service, in military
uniform
again. And so I went in the back door of one of the stores that I was very friendly with, and with the people there. And at any rate, told them they offered me a job, by the way, and I really didn't want that job. I wanted what I considered to be a more long-term
career.
And the people who owned the store, a very successful store, had a friend in downtown Madison that had an employment agency. And they sent me to him on Monday. I arrived on Saturday, and they sent me to him on Monday. And on Tuesday, I had an interview with the insurance company that I ended up being with. I went to work the following day, and I was there for 30 years.
Nice. So you didn't use a GI Bill or anything for further education then?
No.
Okay.
No.
Did you continue any friendships with people that you knew in the service?
Oh, yes. Yeah. And still do. I don't get to see them very much. But having been in government, the Washington, D.C. area,
mm-hmm.
I had plenty of opportunities to see the Vietnam place where all of the people who died in Vietnam the wall. The fact of the matter is, none of the people that were my friends, close friends and worked with were on that wall.
Yeah, that's awesome.
I did not find a single one. And that was pretty good. And I had time to see a few of those people and talk to them, and we would stay in touch to some degree. And none of them are local here where I am now. And while I'm involved with Vietnam veterans here in Wisconsin, I made several new friends, that I hadn't had over there.
Nice. So you work with the Vietnam veterans locally. Do you belong to any other veteran organizations here?
No.
Okay.
No.
Have you attended any reunions, or have you been offered any reunions?
They have reunions regularly. They are the Black Horse Regiment does has an annual one. I've not attended any of those. I went on with a different life.
Okay.
At that point, and. While I stayed, and I still get the magazine, I read everything, every month, but I wasn't involved anymore.
Do you think that your experience in the military changed the kind of employee you were after the military?
Sure, sure. There's no question about it. What it amounts to is you need to find a way to have a strong, important work to do and do it in order to succeed. And that's true whether you were in the military or not, but it was clear in that situation. I came back different.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
What does patriotism mean to you?
That's a hard one to describe in a way. because there are a lot of people who consider themselves patriots that are, feel very different about things than I feel. And so it's, I'm not sure that there's a one way to describe patriotism, but you need to have one yourself and recognizing that there are a lot of other people who look at it altogether different than you do.
And how do you look at it?
I look at it as this country is the best place to live that I have ever encountered. And I think it's because our thinking is in general good for the society and for all of the people here. Right. We are not actually always real good to everybody, but you can't find any other countries or places that are any better about how they do things.
When future generations are looking at, say, your video or finding out about the Vietnam War or something like that, what is there anything that them to hear or to glean from your experience?
Yeah, I think so. And and that's hard. But there are people that ask that know that I've been, in the Army and in Vietnam and in combat, most of the time that I was there. They don't have a good idea of what war is, and they tend to marginalize it, and they need to know that war is a terrible thing, no matter who you are, and no matter what country you work for, and any of that, it's terrible. It's horrible. And a lot of people just have not ever gotten that, and they sort of wipe it off. So it's kind of tough to talk to some people about that sort of thing, but they're all interested. And especially when they find out that I was, in battle most of the time. I don't talk about that very much.
About the veteran in general, whether from Vietnam all the way through today, mm-hmm. What do you think, what would you like more people to know about veterans these days?
There are a lot of them that ended up as good as I did. But on the other hand, there are more that are have been treated less well as I have. And it is much more difficult for a lot of people that I meet nowadays. So it's a different situation. And I can see that we have not done as good a job as we should.
Better, but not the best.
Right, better. And, I think it's better than a lot of other countries have, but not good enough.
Is there anything else you'd like to talk about in your story?
Well, I think it was a... my brother told me he had been in already for 2 years when I went in, that you'll just have to, put in bear it, don't volunteer for anything, and, just stay away from anything that you can. And that didn't set with me, because when I went in, I said, I'm going to take, get the best job, do the best job I can, get the most out of it that I can get out of it. Mm-hmm. And I did. And I learned a lot. And I had the opportunity to do a lot of great things for great people. And that's what I talk about. And that's the way I would like it to end.
Well, Vern, thank you for sharing your story.
You're welcome.